Very good morning, all of you. At the outset, I welcome all my students for the session 6 on the subject Design of Steel Structural Elements 18CB61. So now I will be introducing to plastic method of analysis and design as a part of the module 1. In fact, in the previous class, I discussed about the limit state method, working stress method of analysis, what are the advantages and disadvantages. And also we have seen many of the definitions related to limit state method of analysis as per IS 800/2007. And at the end, I was discussing about the importance of characteristic values, characteristic load, characteristic strength, and what are the various uncertainties that comes into picture and how to define the partial safety factor for strength and also for the load. And with the help of these partial safety factors and how to calculate the design strength and also the design load. So these are all some of the things we discussed in the previous class as a part of the module 5. And today I'll be introducing to the plastic method of analysis and design, but we are not studying in greater detail as to what this plastic design is all about. And bit of introduction I'll be giving at the end of this chapter as a part of the design. Otherwise, the importance is to introduce to you the plastic method of analysis. So students can definitely expect one full question, maybe on a simply supported beam or fixed beam or any type of simple beams, or it can be a problem related to the analysis of continuous beams. So before I take up the plastic method of analysis, let us see what this elastic method of design is all about. In fact, we have seen it in the earlier classes, but still to appreciate plastic method of analysis, we need to know a bit of working stress method of analysis. The working stress method of analysis, my dear friends, is also referred to as the allowable stress method of analysis, and we allow certain percentage of the yield stress in the material. So that's where it is called as allowable stress, and at that stress, the material is really working in good condition, carrying all possible loads and the load effect without undergoing any failure. This is the conventional method of design, which is mainly based on the elastic property of the steel. And in fact, we have appreciated this in the elastic zone of the stress strain diagram, or even the moment curvature relationship as a part of the bending analysis. The structure usefulness of the material is limited up to certain allowable stress, which is always below the elastic limit. So we are not stressing the material even up to the elastic limit, even though that happens to be the limiting value. So we apply some factor of safety and we reduce the elastic stress, and that reduced stress is what is referred to as the allowable stress. And up to that allowable stress only the usefulness of the material is considered. But it is not so in case of plastic analysis, which you'll be seeing later. The stresses due to working loads do not exceed the specified allowable stress. So whatever the load that is acting on the structure, and based on that, if we calculate the stress corresponding to that working condition, and that stress should not be more than the allowable stress, which is the permissible stress. As long as the actual stress is less than the allowable stress, the design is considered to be safe. So that's what the criteria as far as elastic design method is concerned. And as I mentioned, we'll be using one factor called as the factor of safety applied onto the stress, and how that factor of safety is defined. So the factor of safety, as I mentioned, is applied onto the yield stress, which is the maximum stress that is permitted in the elastic method of analysis. Anything beyond yield stress will not be considering. The allowable stress, the stress that can be permitted, is equal to the yield stress of the material. Here the material is steel, divided by the adequate factor of safety. And this adequate factor of safety, I have already explained in one of the earlier classes. And this factor of safety depends on what is the load to which the material is subjected to. Is it the direct tension, direct compression, whether buckling comes into picture or not, whether it is a member subjected to bending, shear. So there are many such things we need to consider, and many of these things are already discussed in IS 800 and in one of the appendix at the end of the book. So you can just refer and appreciate as to what these different factor of safeties are. The elastic design does not take into account the strength of the material beyond the elastic stress. So elastic stress, proportionality stress, yield stress, they are almost close to each other with a small difference, as you can see in the stress strain diagram. So let us not worry much about that, but there is a limit up to which we assume the behavior to be elastic, and that is linear. The material is linearly elastic, and anything beyond that where the material undergoes continuous yielding. So that part is really not considered, and that is what the implication of this statement is all about. Structures designed according to this method will be heavier than that designed by the plastic method. So this is what has been observed by the investigators. So elastic method of analysis, though it is safe from the point of economy, it is not that good. So obviously the sections are bit heavier compared to the sections what we get by way of plastic method of design. Now let us see what this plastic method of design is all about. And of course, first we need to do the analysis and then the design part. The ultimate load is regarded as the design criteria. So it is not the elastic load, it is not the working load, it is the ultimate load. And also we have seen as to what this ultimate load is. In one of the earlier classes, this has been discussed in greater detail. The ultimate load is found from the strength of steel in the plastic range. Means the material is subjected to the maximum load, at which the material is no longer be able to take any load in excess of that, and that is what is referred to as the limiting strength of the material. And that limiting strength of the material is referred to as the ultimate strength of the material, and corresponding to that we calculate the ultimate load, so which is the maximum load resisted by the material, and that particular load corresponds to the behavior of the material in the plastic region. That's what the meaning of this sentence. So this method is also referred to as method of load factor design or the ultimate load design, because the working load is increased up to the load factor, up to the ultimate load, and where that ultimate load is obtained by multiplying the actual load that is acting on the structure, being referred to as the characteristic load, and that characteristic load is increased by a factor. So that is what is referred to as the amplified load, that is by way of a load factor. The strength of the steel beyond the yield stress is fully utilized in this method. So what is this strength beyond the yield stress? So that's what we'll be able to appreciate with the help of the stress strain diagram, or even with the help of moment curvature diagram, which we'll be seeing in just few minutes. So this method of plastic analysis is rapid and provides a rational approach for the analysis of the structure. So this method also provides striking economy as regard to weight of the steel. So this point I have already told. So the section is somewhat lighter as far as the plastic method of design is concerned. Otherwise, the section is slightly heavier when you design it by way of elastic method. And also the approach is quite rational. So whatever the assumptions we do, yes, we'll be able to understand and appreciate all these assumptions, because it is based on the engineering approach. So that is where we call this method as quite rational. So not that the method is based on some experiences, as we see in working stress method of analysis. As I mentioned, the sections are smaller in size than those designed by the method of elastic design. So obviously that happens to be one of the important advantage. Plastic design is effectively used in the analysis and design of statically indeterminate beams and framed structure. And of course, there's not much of an advantage we get from the design if it is a statically determinate structure. So what I want to tell you is, if you are analyzing and designing a simply supported beam for any combinations of the load, so what the sections you get by way of design is more or less same, whether it is a working stress method of analysis or even a plastic method of analysis, because the section is statically determinate. So redundancy doesn't come into picture. So we have to look for those structures where it is indeterminate in nature, where there is a scope for redistribution of moment, and even after any one of the sections in the structure undergoes yielding, the structure is not going to fail, but those structural parts which have not yielded start resisting the load, and as a result of that, distribution of the load carrying capacity, the moment carrying capacity of the structure takes place from one portion of the structure to another portion. So this is where the redistribution of the burden comes into picture. Thereby, additional loads can be applied onto the element. So that's where the indeterminate beams and frames comes into picture, and that's where the real advantage of plastic method will be able to explore in such situations of indeterminate structural elements. My dear friends, let us see the basis for the plastic theory. What property of the material we are looking at in plastic method of analysis? It is all about the ductility of steel. What really happens to the material when the material is just at the verge of undergoing yielding? The elastic limit is reached. Now it is about to yield, and it really yields. What happens at that time? So at that level of stress, at that level of loading, at that level of burden, the material seamlessly undergoes deformation. So this is where the continuous yielding of the material at a constant stress, and that constant stress is also quite uniform across the section. So this is what is referred to as the continuous yielding, and that stress is referred to as the yield stress. And this property of continuous yielding is what is being utilized in this plastic method of analysis. And this is nothing but the ductility of the material. So this has been discussed in one of the earlier classes with the help of stress strain diagram, which I'll be considering now also. And I will show you the figure in the next slide. So before that, I have two parts being defined in the stress strain diagram. So one is the elastic region, where the elastic straining of the material is happening, and that is represented as OA. Please remember OA. And BC represents the yielding of the material when the stress remains constant across the section. And that constant stress, as you know, it is the yield stress Fy. At Fy, the material continuously undergo deformation, and that is what is referred to as the horizontal plateau. So it is the region where the stress is constant. Plastic strain is at least 10 times as large as the elastic strain. So this is what the plastic method expects. But of course, as far as this particular thing is concerned, so the different codes will have different specifications, and you will see what IS 800 is tells about this particular plastic strain. So what amount of plastic strains we really need to have as far as our Indian code of practice is concerned, which I'll be discussing. But otherwise, in an average, about 10 times of the elastic strain should be there at the end of the plastic deformation, if that as a horizontal plateau. So if that is the situation, so that particular material can be used for the plastic method of analysis. So whatever I just mentioned as elastic straining OA and continuous plastic straining BC, that you will be able to see in this particular diagram. And of course, this diagram is taken from the internet source, and the same diagram I have presented in one of the earlier classes. And now if you recollect whatever I explained on that particular class, so here, so there are different points being the salient points on the stress strain diagram. So we have the engineering stress strain diagram, and we have the actual stress strain diagram. So these things we have discussed. And kindly see this region OA, so being the elastic region, and this is the proportionality point. And of course, we have the elastic point slightly above that, and where the behavior is slightly nonlinear. And of course, we have the yield point, and also we have the upper yield point and lower yield point, and even that also I showed in one of the specific stress strain diagram. So let us not worry much about all these things. I am really not distinguishing at this stage as to what this proportionality point and what the elastic point and what is this upper and lower yield point. Let us assume that all these things are rather confined more or less at a particular point. And that is where the idealization of the stress strain diagram also comes into picture. And OA happens to be the elastic zone. Though we have a small change from A to B, so let's not worry much about that. And from B to C, so this is what is very, very important in plastic method of analysis, and that is what is referred to as the perfect plasticity or the yielding of the material. So any material which is having this particular property of continuous yielding is the material qualified for the plastic method of analysis. So we have many other metals which are really plastic, which are elastic, but they are not perfectly plastic. So that is where defining what is perfectly elastic and perfectly plastic comes into picture, which I'll be discussing in a short moment from now. But if you take aluminium as a material, you will not be having this horizontal plateau, whether it is aluminium or even cast iron for that matter, and brass, bronze, as a structural material, we really cannot use it. And also, even if you want to use it, you really don't have this horizontal plateau. So this continuous deformation at a constant yield stress is only the property of mild steel. So that is the reason any structural element made of mild steel can be designed based on this plastic method of analysis. Now, whatever we have as a strain hardening zone, where the strength of the material is increasing, and of course with continuous deformation, and at some point where the stress is ultimate in nature, so the material starts to undergo failure. The yielding of course increases continuously, but the resistance of the material, as I mentioned, it decreases. So this particular portion DE is referred to as the softening zone, where the strength of the material decreases, but the material is not going to fail, but the material undergoes continuous deformation. So this is what is referred to as the strengthening zone or the strain hardening zone. And of course, the hardening means whatever the strain that happens in that particular zone, so it will be there in the material as a set. So that has to happen, and you will not be able to recover that strain as a part of the plastic deformation. So what the idealization will be doing is, we'll just take this elastic behavior as if it is linearly elastic up to the yield, and from yield point, and of course we take this straight perfect yielding, and the behavior what I have is a strain hardening, and even that also will be considered as if it is straight. So this horizontal plastic plateau is simply extended to cover the strain hardening part also, so that we have a perfect elastic behavior and a perfect plastic behavior. So this perfect elastic and perfect plastic behavior, if you take it together, it is referred to as a perfectly plastic material. And also we will see more about this particular definition, because we need to define the property not only in tension, even in compression. So that is where perfectly plastic material comes into picture. So from the perspective of the definition, so we'll wait for some time. So there I'll clarify as to what this definition is all about. So I want to tell you more about what the magnitude of the strain corresponding to the onset of the yielding, or maybe corresponding to the point where the elastic behavior ceases. And if that is what the strain, and what will be the magnitude of the strain corresponding to the point C. And that point C is nothing but the strain hardening point. So from that point onwards, we need to increase the load on the material. The material in fact resists the strength, but with continuous deformation. So if you want to cause deformation, so strength has to increase, the load has to increase. So that's what the meaning. And we will see the idealized the moment curvature relationship in bending, because this particular chapter we mainly focus on the analysis of flexural members. So that is the reason I have taken the behavior in bending. So this is what is referred to as the moment curvature relationship. So the moment curvature relationship, or even the stress strain relationship in an axial tension or in an axial compression, is more or less of the same type. So whatever the diagram I have presented here is more or less similar to the stress strain diagram in tension and the stress strain diagram in compression, though it is different. But the initial two parts of elastic behavior and the plastic behavior is more or less comparable, and it can be idealized. But here we have the strain hardening and strain softening in tension, but it is something like the strain hardening only as far as the compression behavior of the material is concerned in axial compression. Now if you consider very carefully this particular diagram, the salient points and the salient zones, so you'll be able to appreciate the importance of material from the point of plastic method of analysis. Now kindly see, this is the point where I have not loaded the material. Assume that you have a simply supported beam where I am loading the beam, just I am about to apply the load. If I apply the load, Yes, the BMT floods, and definitely there will be certain type of bending moment diagram, shear force diagram as a part of the span, and at some particular point the bending moment is maximum, and that bending moment keep on increases as I increase the load. Now assume that the moment is being increased, and this is how it increases, something like this, and finally we get a point where the moment is referred to as MY, and we'll see what this MY shortly. And if you increase the load further, the moment increases up to a point where it is referred to as MP. That is where fully plastic moment capacity of the section, or the plastified capacity of the section, comes into picture. And as far as this MY is concerned, the yield moment capacity of the section, that is where one of the extreme fiber will have the yield stress. Just the yield stress has reached either in tension or in compression, depending on the situation. And if you increase the load further, even after MP, the moment carrying capacity increases, and it increases up to something like 1.5 MP. So this is how the moment keep on increases as the load on the beam is increased. And of course, we have different definitions of moments depending on what the distribution of the stress across the section is all about. And now if you see what happens as the moment is increased from 0 up to say 1.5 times of the plastified moment. So the curvature also has to increase, the rotation also has to increase. The rotation and curvature has its own importance, which we'll be seeing when I take up the problem later. Now kindly see, the relationship between the moment and the curvature is 100% linear. Kindly see, up to this point it is linear. So that's where it is linearly elastic in nature. And after that, the moment curvature relationship becomes somewhat nonlinear. So that also you'll be able to see here. So what is the amount of this nonlinear behavior? Mainly depends on the type of the cross section, whether it is a I section, and even in I section, what is the thickness of the web, whether the thickness is very small or somewhat somewhat considerable. So that is where the importance of this nonlinear part comes into picture. And if you have a rectangular, so this curve, curved part is somewhat it's somewhat appreciable. And if you have a section in the form of a diamond, or maybe in the form of a triangle, so where most of the area is concentrated near the centroid, and we have still a slightly larger amount of this nonlinear deformation coming into picture. So what I want to do here as a part of the idealization is, so what this nonlinear part is there, it is not that easy to consider this in the design, because we have to do some sort of a nonlinear analysis. In order to simplify the approach of analysis, so we will be making some assumptions. So what is that? Anyway, you have the initial linear part. Extend that part as if it is going in a linear manner. And we also have the perfect plastic zone, as you can see here, over certain length. You extend this horizontal behavior backwards so that the material is assumed to be plastic as far as horizontal is concerned. Extend this elastic behavior at this particular point where the nonlinearity commences, as if it is progressing further and further as a straight part. At some point, both the straight lines meet. So we assume that up to this particular point, so where the intersection of the two straight lines comes into picture, the material is assumed to be behaving in an elastic manner, linearly elastic manner, as far as the moment carrying capacity is concerned, and the moment curvature relationship is assumed to be linear, straight line. And from this particular point, we assume that the material is undergoing continuous deformation, and that continuous deformation in this particular case is the continuous rotation of the section. The cross section is a certain portion of the beam which has undergone plastification. So there is also sometimes effort to ask how the curvature of that portion where the moment is concentrating as MP makes the sections to rotate. And of course, at this point where we have the strain hardening point, the point where we need to further apply the load, that is where the further moment has to be applied in order to cause further rotation of the curvature. And this entire the strain hardening part is also not considered, and that is considered to vary as if it is constant and plastic. So this is where the continuous plastic behavior, even beyond the strain hardening point, over certain length is being considered. So this is what is referred to as idealized moment curvature, which is bilinear in nature. What is the meaning of bilinear? The first one is completely elastic behavior up to the yield point. And from there, it's a continuous horizontal deformation, continuous horizontal plateau covering certain portion of the real plastic behavior where there is no change in stress is happening. But even some portion of the behavior where the deformation is happening but with increased moment, even that is also being considered as if it is a constant and a continuous change in the deformation, where the deformation in this particular case is the rotation of the curvature. So this is what is referred to as linear and horizontal, being bilinear. We can also do the idealization in this fashion, what is being represented in the other curve. Anyway, that we are not really considering, but since it is available in the textbook, let us appreciate what this is. I am really considering the elastic behavior as depicted by the material, not an issue. But what this nonlinear part have, that nonlinear part I am converting it to a linear part, where I am just trying to join the point where the elastic behavior ceases, the nonlinear behavior starts, that is the point, and the point where the nonlinearity in the plastic zone ceases, and where the continuous plastic deformation of the material starts. So identify these two points, the initial point of the nonlinearity and of course the point where this nonlinearity ends. You simply join with a straight line. So this is the portion where the variation of the stress across the cross section, where you are looking for the moment, there it becomes elastoplastic in nature. The stress distribution across this section, for any point over this linear, so it is elastic in nature. But if you take this particular behavior, the stress distribution is plastic in the extreme fibers and of course elastic also in the central core region. Thereby, it is elastoplastic. And from this particular point onwards, it is 100% plastic in nature, where the cross section is assumed to be fully plastified. So we have the elastic behavior, elastoplastic behavior, and we have the continuous plastic behavior. Elastic, elastoplastic, and continuous plastic is what is referred to as the trilinear idealization. So this is what many people have used in the research, and they have done some analysis. Of course, that is really beyond the scope of our discussion. But what we consider here is the linear, which is elastic, and of course linearly elastic, and then perfect plastic behavior. So this is where the idealization of the material comes into picture. So the definition to these zones, we can also see it here. What is elastic, idealized up to this particular point? What is perfectly plastic as far as the idealization is concerned, almost up to the strain hardening point? And what is this real strain hardening? The real strain hardening is something like this. But from the idealization point of view, the strain hardening is neglected, but what the deformation the material undergoes beyond the strain hardening is simply considered. So we are not giving importance to the increase in strength, but what the deformation the material undergoes is considered, which is beyond the point of strain hardening. Now let us see one important concept as far as the plastic material is concerned. So that is where the steel is referred to as a perfectly plastic material. So try to understand, what is the meaning of perfectly plastic material? Of course, it is a plastic material. It is a linearly elastic material. That linearly elastic behavior and the plastic behavior should be more or less same, not only in the tension side, but also in the compression side. So if you take a specimen of a mild steel and subject that to stress strain test, and if you plot the stress strain diagram, and then you idealize, so we have the linear part and of course we have the plastic part. Similarly, if you conduct the compression test, so let's not worry about the complete stress strain diagram, but the initial linear part and of course the plastic part. So if you consider that and plot to the same scale in a diagram, we are going to get a diagram something like this. So any material which has a behavior something like this in tension and compression is referred to as a perfectly plastic material. But of course it has to satisfy certain other requirements also, as far as the stress, strain and the amount of horizontal plateau is concerned, and the modulus of elasticity, which we'll be seeing in the next slide. So what we have as the idealized linear part and the idealized plastic part in tension, the same thing we have to have the idealized linear part in compression, and of course the continuous plastic part as an extension of that. So the behavior in tension, the behavior in compression should be more or less same. It should be a mirror image, but of course in the opposite sense. So that you will be able to see as a part of the definition here in this particular slide. The same diagram I have put it here. Now kindly see what are all the points we need to consider for calling a material as perfectly plastic. A perfectly plastic material follow Hooke's law up to the limit of proportionality. So this is a very important point. So that's where the stress is proportional to strain. He says up to the point of proportionality. The point of proportionality is taken up to this particular point because it's an idealized diagram. So in an idealized diagram, you are not distinguishing the proportionality point and also the elastic point and the yield point. So because they're all very close to each other and assumed to be concentrated at a point. So this is the point so where the limit of the proportionality comes into picture. The C is of the straight line relation. Stress is proportional to strain. The slope of the stress strain diagram in compression and tension are equal. What is the slope? This is the slope. So take any point on any two points on the stress strain diagram and find out what is the vertical distance and the horizontal distance. So that is where the vertical to horizontal ratio, stress divided by strain, comes into picture for any two points along the linear part. So that is where the proportionality comes into picture, and that is what is being referred to as the modulus of elasticity. So the modulus of elasticity in tension, this one, E, the modulus of elasticity in compression, E in C, E in T. So that should be same. What is the meaning of this? The slope of the line should be same. So what is the meaning? So if you take the angle theta, so the angle with which the straight line exists in tension, the same angle we have to have as far as the straight line of the compression part is concerned. So these are the two angles. So they are equal. So if that happens, automatically E in tension will be equal to E in compression. And this is the second requirement. Now what is the third requirement? Yield stress in tension and compression are equal. So what is the meaning of this? So what this particular stress you are talking of, that stress and this stress, that should be same. So you are going to get the same behavior, but what is the magnitude of the yield stress in tension? It may be 250, but the magnitude in compression should not be anything other than 250. Even if it is 240 or 230, yes, the behavior is same, but the maximum value of the stress in tension and compression, they are different. That should not happen. So that is where the maximum yield stress in tension and the maximum yield stress in compression, so they should be same. If the steel is of yield stress say 250, and that 250 should be the yield stress irrespective of whether the material is tested in tension or in compression. Now what is the another fourth point? The strain up to the strain hardening in tension and compression are also equal. So this is the point we need to be very careful. What is this strain hardening point? Now kindly see, this is the yield point. Is a continuous deformation, and this is what the idealization we have seen. So anything beyond this, if you see, so the increase in strength comes into picture, and of course the material undergoes deformation. Now as far as the idealization is concerned, we have extended it, but otherwise this is the point where the real strain hardening starts. So corresponding to that point of strain hardening, if you draw a ordinate, this is the point where you have the strain corresponding to the strain hardening, and that strain corresponding to strain hardening in the tension should be equal to the same value of strain in the compression. If this condition is also satisfied, than the material is referred to as the perfectly plastic material. Before that, one more thing. The amount of what horizontal plateau you have here. So this horizontal plateau and this horizontal plateau should also be same. So this is horizontal, this is not horizontal. So that is not the condition. So what the diagram I have in tension, it is the perfect diagram in the compression also as a mirror image. And if that happens, the material can be called as perfectly plastic material. As far as an engineering material is concerned, it is the only steel as a material has this particular property. So mathematically, so the modulus of elasticity in tension is equal to modulus of elasticity in compression. The strain corresponding to tension, as far as the stress corresponding to tension at yielding and the stress corresponding to yielding in compression, that is same. And of course, the strain corresponding to strain hardening in tension and the strain corresponding to the same strain hardening in compression, they should be equal. And of course, we have to have the same length of horizontal plateau both in tension and compression. Then the material is perfectly plastic. Now let us see some of the assumptions what we make in plastic method of structural analysis. We have seen the analysis of beams in RCC also. In IS 456-2000, we have certain set of assumptions there also being defined, and the meaning of those assumptions also we have seen in the explanatory handbook. In the same way, here also we have few assumptions being made. Without assumptions, it is extremely difficult to do the analysis and design. So whatever we do as a calculation, so we'll be simplifying those calculations, and our approach to analysis and design becomes easy with assumptions. So assumptions are a must in any of the analysis, because no material is 100% perfect. The material has to obey Hooke's law till the stress reaches Fy. So that's what I have explained earlier also. The yield stress and the modulus of elasticity have the same value in compression and tension. It is nothing but the definition what I mentioned in perfectly plastic material. The same thing, if you bring it here, that becomes the assumption. And what is the meaning then? It is extremely difficult to have a material which is perfectly plastic. So the behavior in tension and behavior in compression has some change, but to the extent of about 85-90-95%, depending on the type of the material, it appears that the behavior is more or less comparable. So that's where we simply assume that both the behavior in tension and compression is more or less same. The material is homogeneous and isotropic in both elastic and plastic state. So what is the meaning of homogeneous? The material at any point, you just see what the material at that particular point and how that material as a material at a point being concentrated and how it really undergo deformation and how it offers resistance. It should be same in all the direction at a particular point. That is where the homogeneity comes into picture. If you go to another point, there also the property is same in all the directions. But whether the magnitude of this property is same or not, that is not known. But it is homogeneous. It's a one material at a particular point. If you take the mechanical properties or the elastic properties, it is more or less same in all the directions. Now, if you take one more point and see what the property. So what property at a point here you are talking of, say in the direction x, we have to have the same property in that x direction when the point is other than a, say point b. So at any two point in a particular direction, if the elastic properties are same, then it is called as isotropic. And of course, otherwise it is orthotropic, and we also have anisotropic. And if the properties do change substantially with respect to two axes which are perpendicular to each other, and we call it as orthotropic. And many of these things you must have studied and appreciated in strength of material. So what I want to tell you is this property of homogeneity and isotropy has to be satisfied for the material when it is stressed up to elastic and also beyond elastic. In both the regions, it should be homogeneous and isotropic. It may not be true but it is more or less acceptable. The material is assumed to be sufficiently ductile to permit large rotation of the section to take place. So the material undergoes a continuous deformation after reaching the yield stress. And what is the amount of that continuous deformation as a ductility? So that is very important, and that is where the specifications of the different course of practices comes into picture. The material has to undergo substantial rotation, substantial deformation after reaching the yield stress. Plastic hinge rotation is large compared with the elastic deformation. So the elastic deformation is very small. So that's where the limit of elastic strain, if you take, that is where epsilon E comes into picture. But what the strain material undergo beyond that, it should be quite substantial, many times, 5 times, 6 times, 8 times, 10 times, 12 times, depending on the type of the material. How much we need to have, that we will see as far as the IS 800 requirements are concerned in a short while. The magnitude of the bending moment caused by the external load will be at the most equal to the plastic moment reached the capacity of the cross section. And I just mentioned that there is a capacity called as MP, where the moment capacity of the section has become maximum. And whatever the way you apply the load, the moment capacity can go up to that value, MP. And whatever the load you apply beyond that, the moment is not going to increase the moment carrying capacity. So that's what the meaning of this sentence is all about. The bending moment caused by the external load can be the maximum, and at the most it is equal to MP, and anything excess of MP is not possible irrespective of the manner in which you load it. The influence of the normal force and the shear force on plastic moment is not considered. And of course the normal force and the shear force has its own effect, and it may even decrease the plastic capacity of the section. So these are all some of the corrections and adjustments we need to do in the design. But as far as the calculation of the plastic moment capacity is concerned, these two things are not considered. And by chance, if these two things are there in the design, appropriately we need to account for the effect, wherein additional plastic capacity also needed to be considered while selecting the section. Plane sections remain plane even after bending, and the effect of shear is neglected. So what is the meaning of the section which is plane before bending has to remain plane even after bending? So this is where the variation of the strain becomes very important, because we know the strain is maximum at the extreme fibers. And if you know the extreme fiber strain with respect to the neutral axis and at a distance x, and if you are interested in knowing what is the strain for any distance with respect to the neutral axis less than x, so we assume that that particular value is proportional to the extreme fiber strain. So if I know the extreme fiber strain at some distance, what is the strain corresponding to any distance below that can be determined by using the proportionality concept. So we assume that the distribution of this strain to be straight, distribution of this strain to be linear. So to satisfy this, so we have to have this particular assumption. Out of plane deformation, out of plane strain is not going to exist because of this particular definition. Of course, the last two assumptions, the equilibrium of forces at the time of collapse is considered for the undeformed state of the structure. And of course, when the material goes to plastic state, certain portion of the beam, we assume that it has completely undergone deformation. So that is where the plastic hinge formation comes into picture. And that plastic hinge, though we assume to be a point, so it is spreading over certain length. And that particular portion we are not considering, but the other portions which are somewhat rigid in nature. So only the behavior of that particular portion which is rigid and the equilibrium of that rigid part is what is being considered in the analysis, and the deformed part is not considered. No stability occurs in any member of the structure up to collapse. So no instability occurs. Means we need to ensure that your structure as a whole and your structural element is stable in nature. So instability is not there. So instability by way of buckling, buckling of web or buckling of flange should not happen. So for a certain length of flange or for a certain depth of flange, the thickness should be appropriate, that there is no local buckling taking place up to the plastic collapse. So this is what the assumption. Now with this assumption, let us move further and say some of the limit stipulations being mentioned in IS 800/2007. So you have IS 456/2000 being referred to as the mother code as far as concrete is concerned, and we call this as the mother code for steel. So whatever you want to do as an analysis in design in RCC, we need to refer IS 456, and following that code is mandatory. So here also, if you want to design steel as per 800 steel, so use of this IS 800/2007 becomes compulsory and mandatory. You should not violate any provisions that are there in IS 800. The following conditions should be satisfied in order to use the plastic method of analysis. So this is what IS 800 says. The first thing is with respect to the yield stress. In fact, we have seen steel with different yield stresses, and if we just open out your IS 800, we have FI 220, 230, 250, 280, 300, 350, 400, 450. It can even go up to 550. If you see from the manufacturer's table, it can even cross beyond 600 also. But at present, so this plastic method of analysis is applicable to steel where the yield strength is not exceeding 450. You please remember 450 MPa being the limiting strength. The stress strain characteristics of the steel used should obey the following conditions in order to ensure plastic moment redistribution. So this plastic moment redistribution is some concept we will be seeing in indeterminate structures, and this may not be there in simply supported beam, and it is really not there in simply supported beam. What these points are: the first point, the yield plateau, the horizontal portion of the stress strain diagram, should be greater than 6 times the yield strength. In fact, when I explained this, so there are situations where this continuous deformation can go up to 10 to 12 times, but a minimum of 6 times of the yield strain has to be there. The strain corresponding to the end of the horizontal plateau should be at least equal to 6 times compared to the strain which just starts at the beginning of the horizontal plateau. The ratio of the ultimate tensile stress to the yield stress should be more than 1 point. And if you recollect how the stress strain diagram is varying, so the yield stress, suppose if it is 250, and where that ultimate strength is. So the ultimate strength is definitely above the yield strength, and there should be at least 20% more. Suppose if you have a yield strength of 300, 20% of 300 is, it is 60. So ultimate strength should be minimum of 360 and above, as far as the yield strength of 300 MPa is concerned. So that's what they mean. The elongation of the material on a standard gauge length should be more than 15%. And of course, we have seen in the stress strain diagram, the deformation corresponding to the elongation corresponding to the ultimate strength is close to 15 to 18%, and at the time of failure, so at the end of the softening behavior, so it will be very close to 25 to 30%. But at least 15% of continuous elongation on a standard gauge length should be there before the material fractures. If these points are ensured, so we can adopt the plastic method of analysis. And of course, we also have one more point. So D, the steel should exhibit strain hardening capacity. So what is the meaning of this? So when the material undergo continuous deformation at the end of the horizontal plateau, it should not simply continue to deform, but it has to resist the load and deform, and that has to happen. And that is where going up to 20% in excess of yield stress comes into picture. Otherwise, 1.2 becomes meaningless. So increase in yield stress up to 20% of that as ultimate strength is one thing, but the material also has to undergo continuous deformation. So that's where the nonlinear behavior also should be exhibited by the element. The member shall be hot rolled or fabricated using the hot rolled plate. So what is the meaning of this? It should be hot rolled, but it should not be cold formed. So at this juncture, it is extremely difficult for me to make you understand what is this hot rolled and cold formed. And we have entirely a different family of steel where it is formed from thin plates and sheets where the thickness is hardly 1 mm, 2 mm, something like this. We press the material and convert the material for a particular shape, but it is made from a parent material which is like a sheet having a small thickness of say 1 mm, 2 mm, and they are the formed materials. And your plastic analysis is really not applicable to such type of form materials. Cold formed materials, the shape is given when the material is in cold condition, where the material width to thickness ratio is so high, it is susceptible to local buckling. So when you apply some load in excess of some critical value, the material buckles. The stress corresponding to that is always be less than the yield stress. So the question of stress reaching the yield and then the cross section reaching MP and undergoing continuous deformation without local buckling is really not possible. So that is possible only in case of hot rolled elements. So using such type of a hot rolled plates, we need to fabricate the sections. So if they are the type of I sections and fabricated sections, so the plastic method of analysis is applicable. Cross section of the member not containing plastic hinges should be compact, and those of members containing plastic hinge should be plastic. So what is the meaning of this? So in fact, I explained the classification of the section also in one of the earlier classes. So the section is said to be plastic where it is completely plastifying, where the section resistance is MP, but with that constant resistance the material undergoes continuous deformation. So that is where it is plastic. But it reaches the plastification, we have MP, but at that level the material is not in a position to undergo continuous deformation. It undergo bit of deformation and eventually it fails, but continuous deformation is not there. So obviously the continuous rotation of the portion of the member in the form of a plastic hinge is not going to take place. So that is the reason. So you have to have the plastic section, but sometimes compact section is also permitted, but anything less than compact is not permitted. The cross section of the member not containing plastic hinge should be compact. Where there is a plastic hinge, it should be 100% plastic. Means that at those locations where you define the plastic hinge is likely to form, so that particular location has to undergo continuous plastic deformation. The remaining portions need not have to undergo deformation, but it should be at least compact. So the question of semi-compact or the slender is not permitted as a part of plastic analysis. The cross-section should be symmetrical about its axis, perpendicular to the axis of the plastic hinge rotation. And of course, many of these things we'll be able to appreciate in the subsequent sections where we take up some examples. There I will make some of these things very clear. The cross section should be symmetric about its axis perpendicular to the axis of the plastic hinge rotation. It is something like a doubly symmetric section, like a rectangle, like a square, or even a symmetric I section. So they are the type of sections we need to consider. Or otherwise, your section should have at least one axis of symmetry, something like what we have in case of a T-section. If that is what the situation, yes, this plastic analysis can be employed. These limitations are intended to ensure that there is a sufficiently long plastic plateau to enabling a hinge to form, and that the steel will not experience premature strain hardening. So the meaning is that once the yielding of the section starts, the material has to undergo continuous deformation, and thereby you will be able to see the hinge portion is actually undergoing rotation. But without undergoing plastic rotation, the material should not reach to the strain hardening point where it resists additional load and undergo deformation. So we will not be able to really see the continuous deformation at a constant moment happening. Now let us see the bending, what really happens in a simply supported beam where it is symmetric about both the axes. So the example what I am considering here is a rectangular section, but rectangular section in steel is rarely we see. It is a rolled section in the form of an I section where it is doubly symmetric. So let us see what the distribution of stress across this I section. When that I section is used as a beam, simply supported beam, I am taking it as an example. So you can see the beam what I have mentioned here, a simply supported beam subjected to some load at any point. Let us assume that it is at the midpoint. So increase the load. So load from minimum and going up to maximum, where the structure really undergo collapse. So at regular interval, the load is being increased. So definitely the beam deflects. So the deflection profile we see in the next slide, the deflection increases. The slope at the support also increases. The curvature of the beam increases. The bending moment at a particular section, the section where you are applying the moment also keep on increases. The shear force near the support also increases. All structural parameters do increase. So this is what you need to appreciate. When that happens at a particular cross section where the bending moment is maximum, what is the distribution of the stress? So that is what we are interested in this analysis. Bending of beams symmetrical about both axes. So this is the best example for the beam which is symmetric with respect to both the axes. So the first one is the rectangular section having width b, and of course the overall depth is d. So you also have the I section and then the distribution of the bending stress. Assume that we have applied some load, there is some moment, the stress in the extreme fiber is having some value, but it has not gone up to Fy. The stress in the extreme fiber is always be less than Fy. And the moment carrying capacity of this particular section is referred to as the elastic moment carrying capacity, because the stress is less than the yield stress. And by chance this extreme fiber stress attains the yield stress Fy, both at top and bottom as far as the symmetric section is concerned, then the moment carrying capacity corresponding to that is referred to as the yield moment capacity. The first one is the elastic capacity for any value of the stress where stress is less than Fy at the extreme fibers, but when it becomes Fy, the capacity corresponding to that is the yield moment capacity. But still the distribution is linear, not only in contention part but also in compression part. Now if we increase the load further, what happens? Now you have a situation something like this, where the extreme fiber has attained the yield stress. But if you increase the load further and further, the strain across the cross section keep on increases, which you'll be seeing in the subsequent slides. But there is a limit on the stress. This stress in the extreme fiber cannot exceed Fy, because Fy is the limit. But the fibers which are below, which are under stressed, so they will also be stressed to Fy. So like that substantial depth of the beam at the top and also at the bottom, where we have certain number of fibers, all these fibers do yield, but the strain across the cross section still continues to increase. But if you see the portion near the center, near the central core, it is still in the elastic, condition. So this is what is referred to as the plastic condition at the extreme top and extreme bottom, and near the center it is behaving elastically. So this type of a stress distribution is referred to as elastic plastic stress distribution. So that also you'll be able to see in the cross section which part of the portion, the top and bottom, is plastified, and that I am showing in the form of a hatched part. But near the center, where it is not hatched, is the elastic behavior. So if you increase the load further, so obviously the yielding of the cross section spreads further and further towards the centroidal axis, and at some stage the entire cross section, not only in the compression and even in the tension, completely yields. So that is where the complete plastification of the cross section comes into picture, and the moment carrying capacity corresponding to this is referred to as the fully plastic moment carrying capacity, or the plastified capacity of the section. So fully plastified cross section, and the capacity of the cross section is fully plastified moment capacity. So this is elastic plastic distribution, and of course the capacity is in excess of the yield, but of course it is definitely less than the MP. So elastoplastic moment capacity, but if you see, this is the elastic capacity, where the capacity is definitely less than the yield capacity. The stress is not equal to Fy at the extreme fiber. So elastic capacity, elastic moment, elastoplastic capacity, elastoplastic section, and of course that distribution of the stress across the section, and this is the fully plastified cross section, where the distribution of the stress is completely like this, where it is completely yielded. So with this, so how the different properties of the cross sections can be defined, and what will happen to the neutral axis, and where exactly that neutral axis exists. So there are many things that comes into picture, and we have still many concepts needed to be discussed, and many of these things I'll be discussing in the next class. So thank you very much, my dear friends, for listening to me. So we will see the rest of the thing in the next class. So if you have any questions at this stage, so we can ask, so that we can have some more time from the discussion point of view. So thank you very much.